Oh, loud. All right, so at equilibrium, we have these powerful tools relating response to things like system structure. But living things rely, for many of their key functions, on highly sensitive non-equilibrium chemical systems. And because these are out of equilibrium, the sort of classical tools of physics abandon us. But what I hope to sort of show you today is that because a diverse set of these sensitivity mechanisms are modeled very similarly, there is actually a prospect for a general theory of sensitivity applies in or out of equilibrium. And I'll show you a sort of piece of that theory today. So when talking about sensitivity in a biological context, I think it's almost mandatory to begin with the discussion of the binding curve of oxygen to hemoglobin. So these are, the shape of this curve was found in classic experiments from the early 20th century. On the x-axis, we have the partial pressure of oxygen above the blood, which is proportional to the concentration of oxygen within. And then on the y-axis, we have the oxygen uptake by the blood, right? The oxygen taken up by hemoglobin. And what's striking here, and the different curves correspond to different values of the partial pressure of carbon dioxide. What's striking, especially for this curve with the high carbon dioxide pressure, but in fact for all of them, is their sigmoidal shape, right? The slope increases at zero. And when this was first discovered, it was unexpected, because people had expected a different thing, which is that if one molecule of hemoglobin combines with one molecule of oxygen, just from chemical kinetics, you should expect a different shape, this hyperbolic curve, where the slope is always decreasing. Okay, so this sigmoidal shape, which in a sort of precise sense is more sensitive than that one, and I'll explain that later, and that sensitivity is functionally important, that shape is functionally important. This was unexpected and needed explanation. And Hill, who was a mathematician turned physiologist, gave the following explanation, which is that the shape of these binding curves could be explained by multiple oxygen molecules binding sort of together to aggregations of hemoglobin, which at least initially he imagined there being a range of aggregates of different sizes. And so that's close, but not quite the modern understanding of this. But the point is that if multiple oxygen molecules bind at once, we can have a curve. Hill showed that you can expect a binding curve with the following form, which is called a Hill function now. And this parameter h is the Hill coefficient. You can see here that as the Hill coefficient increases, we get more and more sigmoidal type curves. The sensitivity to the argument at 1, for instance, increases the slope. So in this example, let's say x is the concentration of something that binds, oxygen, and f of x is some observable, let's say the amount that's taken up by the blood. So, so now in fact, almost nothing is really a Hill function. So, if you treat binding correctly, in general, you won't get a Hill function. Many other generating processes for input-output relations will not give you this form, but the Hill, it's very common to fit sigmoidal curves to a Hill function in biophysics. And the Hill coefficient sort of exists, more generally, sometimes called the effective Hill coefficient, as a measure of logarithmic sensitivity. Because, you can always take the logarithmic derivative of some function with respect to its argument. And if it were a Hill function, you would get the following form, where the Hill coefficient appears kind of prominently. More generally, this kind of equation is the basis for talking about the Hill coefficient more generally. Okay, so that's a sort of specific example. It's a specific mechanism. It's a specific system. But I said that at equilibrium, which I'll explain, you know, more precisely later, but you know, one can just think of there being no net energy expenditure in this process. For any mechanism, let's say, of binding at thermodynamic equilibrium, then a very simple law holds, relating the sensitivity, let's say, to the ligand concentration, to the variation in the number of ligands bound. So you can passively observe fluctuations in the number of ligands bound and predict the sensitivity if you were to change the ligand concentration. And you know, to see this, we can we apply these tools from physics, as I said. We can work in the grand canonical ensemble, which tells us that the probability of any system state in which NB ligands is bound is given by this exponential of the chemical potential times the number bound. Or I should say it's proportional to that. And it's proportional also to the exponential of NB times log of X, where X is the concentration. And so you know, there's more going on here. This is just proportionality, but that's all we need for our purposes, because now we can take the derivative. This is how X enters into the probability of the states. And so we can take the derivative with respect to X, and we can get results like this one, relating the response. Let's say we're interested in something like the number of ligands bound, the number of ligands bound on average divided by the total number that can be bound. And we're interested in how that depends on the concentration X. Yes?
So a very stupid question.
Yeah.
Why is the chemical potential the log of the concentration?
Okay, so interesting. So there's many ways to see this. First of all, it's not exactly equal to the log of the concentration. It's there'll be some other term, but it's being absorbed in the proportionality. And yeah, this is a standard result, but if you view the you can derive it, for instance, by viewing the chemical potential as the change in entropy when one particle goes in or out of a solution where things are present at one concentration. From that definition, you can get this expression. Incidentally, this also, there are many ways to derive this. So another equivalent way is if every binding reaction is linear, the rate is linear in the concentration X, and you're at equilibrium, you've got detailed bounds, the same, you can prove the same result. So that's equivalent. The two things are equivalent. So given this, so you can find the following result, which is that this response is equal to the variance in the number bound divided by the mean. Okay. And that's also less than this Hill-like expression where we've got the observable, 1 minus the observable. Remember before we had 1 minus fx over here, times a parameter n, which is the number of the maximum number of ligands that can be bound. So this justifies saying that the effective Hill coefficient is always less than n, the number of binding sites. That's one way to justify that statement, even if this is not really going to be a Hill function. Okay. Good. So any questions? I'm happy to, people should feel free to interrupt whenever. Okay, good. Okay, so that's at equilibrium. But I said that, as I said, living things use mechanisms, very diverse sort of menagerie of mechanisms that are non-equilibrium mechanisms. And here are just three examples, which are depicted in a way which I'll explain later. And what we'd like to do is develop sort of unified understanding of these. That is, a bit like the equilibrium result we just had, which holds for any mechanism. Okay, so I'm going to describe those general results. But before I get into those general results, I want to give an example, a sort of specific example, of a non-equilibrium sensitivity mechanism where there's experimental evidence that equilibrium description doesn't suffice. And that's the very well comes from a very well studied system, which is chemotaxis in E. coli, which is the system that sort of E. coli uses to move sort of towards attractants, let's say, food and sugar. And the way it works is there's an array of receptors which bind to attractants, chemical attractants. And depending on the binding at the receptors, the concentration of an intracellular protein, KYP, varies. And then KYP binds to the motors, the flagellar motors that move, that turn the flagella and move the bacterium. And according to the binding, it determines whether or not the motors rotate clockwise or counterclockwise. And that controls how the bacterium moves. If they rotate counterclockwise, it runs in a straight line. If they rotate clockwise, it tumbles, changing direction randomly. So that's part of this sort of chemotactic strategy. But for us, what's important is that the fraction of the time that the motor rotates clockwise is very sensitive to the small changes in this KYP concentration. So something is happening. You know, when KYP binds to the motor, there's something very sensitive going on because it's very sensitive to the KYP concentration. Yeah? Oh, that's a good question. You mean the typical time scale of each of them?
Yeah,
so I think it's between a tenth of a second to a second, but maybe others know better than I, the number maybe I get wrong, but I think that's the order of magnitude. Yeah. Okay, good. So given this, you know, we can ask, you know, what kinds of models of what's going on at the motor could explain this sensitivity? And also, you know, are there fundamental limits to sensitivity, perhaps, in terms of energy consumption, number of molecules that are involved, and so forth? The first step to answering these questions is to quantify sensitivity. Okay, so here we go back to what we were discussing earlier. So this is an experiment by Yuan and Berg, quite recent, that tried to measure this relation between the fraction of the time the motor rotates clockwise, the clockwise bias, pi CW, and the concentration of this protein, KYP. And we're looking here at the blue dots, just focus on the blue dots, and there's this very sharp sigmoidal relation. And to quantify sensitivity, they fit this curve to a Hill function, shown here, where is n here, what they call n is the Hill coefficient. They find that it's about 20, 21. And you know, as before, you know, this is not really, there's no reason why it should really be a Hill function, but the sort of right generalization, I think, is the logarithmic sensitivity. So again, if we were taking the log of this pi CW, and it was a Hill function, we would have this expression. Okay. So, again, returning to what we just said, so what do we expect at equilibrium? We can do the same thing, you know, using the grand canonical ensemble, but this time we'll get a different result because our observable is not the average number of ligands bound, as it was in like the hemoglobin example, where it was like how much oxygen has been taken up. Now it's like the probability that the system is in some collection of states. And so now we get a different result, which is that we get the following equality, where we see that the thing that kind of appears in the position of the Hill coefficient is the difference in the number bound on average when the motor rotates clockwise and when it rotates counterclockwise. Yeah, so from the same equilibrium arguments, we get the following equation, which is different because we have a different observable. The fraction of the time the system rotates, the motor rotates clockwise. And the thing that appears in the position of the Hill coefficient in this expression is a difference of two means, the mean number of ligands bound when the motor rotates clockwise minus the number when it rotates counterclockwise. So, okay, so that's interesting. And just to be clear, this is something that you can observe passively. So, you know, you fix the value of KYP and you would see, you know, when it fluctuations switching back and forth and count the number. And I said it was a well-studied system. And in fact, people have done exactly this measurement. All these figures are from a paper by Fukuoka and others in which this was done using fluorescence microscopy. They can observe simultaneously the direction of rotation of a motor and they can quantify how much QIP is bound. And what's interesting for us is what's on the bottom right, which is these histograms they produce of the number of these molecules bound in the clockwise and counterclockwise states. And they find a difference of about 10, 11 in the means. So this is clearly a problem, right? Because at thermodynamic equilibrium, we just said that we should have the following equation. And so the Uhlenberg sensitivity measurement and the Fukuoka observation of number fluctuations in the number bound should sort of be two sides of an equation, right? 10 and 20, but they're not equal. Okay? So this is one of several lines of evidence that point to a non-equilibrium sensitivity mechanism for this system. Okay, so I've been talking about equilibrium, not equilibrium. Now I'm going to actually describe the sort of class of models that my results apply to. Because in order to model non-equilibrium systems, we need a model of kinetics. So for equilibrium, we have things like, we can talk about energies, and that tells us most of what we have to know. That's not okay out of equilibrium. We need to talk about the speeds of all the transitions between states. Good. So what is the model that generalizes, all those non-equilibrium examples I was discussing earlier? And here's the class of models that we're going to discuss. So we imagine we have a system. There are some states that are represented by these dots. And there are transitions between them that happen stochastically at some rates, which are these W parameters. These are the rates of these transitions. So I'm calling this a kinetic scheme. There are many different names. It's also a continuous time Markov chain if we take a stochastic interpretation, although it's also possible to take a deterministic interpretation, which often arises in a chemical context, and that doesn't matter for us in terms of the results that will come. But I will talk about it stochastically. And taking that perspective, if we have some system like this, with some states, some transitions between them, we always have that the distribution of our states, the probability distribution, define the system at a certain state, evolves over time according to this linear equation, the master equation, where this matrix W is the matrix of transition rates. And under weak assumptions, after a long time, the distribution converges to a steady state distribution over states, which is unique, meaning it depends only on the rates and not on the initial condition. Okay, so this is a general sort of model of dynamics. And now we can, in this context, we can make very precise the distinction between equilibrium and non-equilibrium. So there's two kinds of steady states. There are steady states of thermodynamic equilibrium and steady states that are not equilibrium states, which are called non-equilibrium steady states. And to know for a given kinetic scheme which one we're in, which one its steady state is, we have to compute these parameters that are called cycle forces, which are given by, for any cycle, so like a sort of loop in a diagram like this, in this case there's only one cycle, the cycle force, Fc, is the log of the rates going one way around the cycle divided by the rates going the other way around the cycle. Okay? And if those are zero for all the cycles in a kinetic scheme, that's exactly the condition of detailed balance, and we're at thermodynamic equilibrium, or the steady state will be one of thermodynamic equilibrium, and all the tools of physics apply. Otherwise, in general, they won't be zero. We're in the non-equilibrium case, and often, actually, these cycle forces can be given an interpretation as the entropy produced in the environment when the cycle is traversed. So often, for us, it will be like a chemical potential difference that is holding the system out of equilibrium. Yeah, so there's a different FC for every single loop. Exactly, yeah. And they all have to be zero in order to be at equilibrium. But an interesting question could be, if only some cycles are, break detailed balance and others don't, is that an interesting intermediate case? I think that's an interesting question. But, yeah. Okay, so now I'm ready to say sort of what the common picture that unifies a lot of sensitivity mechanisms that arise in the sort of biophysical literature, models of sensitivity mechanisms that arise in the literature is. It's extremely common to have some kinetic scheme, okay, some states, transitions between them, where a parameter X of interest, let's say it's a ligand concentration, but it could be something different, scales linearly some transition rates, which I'm depicting here in red. And never mind about the green for now. It's just a state. So if we've got some scheme like this, it could arise as a model of a chemical system, but there's other possibilities. After some time, as we said, a steady state distribution is established, and that's going to be a function of the transition rates. And so, because the rates are a function of x, the distribution will be a function of x. Okay? And then something that we measure is often going to be an average over that steady state distribution. So that's our observable, which what we were calling fx earlier, an average of a state function over that distribution. Right. So then, and this sort of path can give us a relation between x and an output f of x that could be very sensitive. And so our question is, what does knowing the sensitivity tell us about the scheme, let's say, and what does knowing about the scheme tell us about the sensitivity that can be achieved? Okay, yeah. X is a parameter that scales some transition rates. Yeah. It could be anything, but often it's a ligand concentration. And it appears linearly, for example, because of mass action, let's say. Something binds. Yeah. Okay, so now that I've described that, we can return to the flagellar motor. So here's a model, a kinetic scheme that we might write down for binding of QIP to the motor. If you're familiar, this is like a MWC-like model. But that doesn't matter. But basically, the states are, there's sort of two states, two things that we have to keep track of. How many QIP are bound to the motor? It can be 0 up to n. And is the motor going clockwise or counterclockwise? Okay, so that gives us the states of the system. And then the transitions, the binding transitions, depend on the ligand concentration L. And the other rates, don't depend on L. So if detailed balance is satisfied here, then if we work everything out, we'll get the usual equilibrium result that we were talking about. Now, what Yuhai Tu proposed in a paper in 2008 is to take this model, break detailed balance, and basically just choose the rates differently in a way that violates the constraints that must hold at equilibrium. This could be a model of the non-equilibrium mechanism of the flagellar motor. Okay, so this was proposed in this paper. Yeah. That's right. So that what you're that is what it would need to be to get sensitivity. Exactly. But so something that so there's sort of two questions. One is, what could you do in principle if you are free to choose the rates, right? And then the question is, what mechanism actually does achieve those limits? And today I'm focusing mostly on what the limits are. I think every case that I describe, we do also actually know mechanisms that saturate them. But I'm not discussing that as much. But yeah, so we have this system. And the question is, let's say, as you said, that on the top we have a lot of ligands bound. On the bottom, we don't have many. What then will be the sensitivity, right? There's no reason to expect it would be given by the same expression that's given at equilibrium. Okay, so that class captures many phenomena. And now I'm going to describe sort of three results that apply to all models of that kind. And the description of these results is based on a sort of decomposition of a general perturbation, let's say changing x, into certain kinds of perturbations, which are called vertex perturbations and edge perturbations, which I'll define. The first result is that just like at equilibrium, fluctuations determine the sensitivity to vertex perturbations. The second result is that the driving forces, these FCs, the cycle forces that hold the system out of equilibrium, they bound the sensitivity to these edge perturbations. And finally, that a sort of structural quantity called the support bounds the sensitivity to all perturbations. So I'm going to now go into these results. But before I state them, there's a key sort of tool. So this is where the results come from, which is that the hard part is knowing the link between the rates and the steady state distribution. There is one, right? There's a unique function. It's a function, but it's a very messy function of the transition rates. But this theorem gives us an explicit expression for the steady state distribution in terms of the rates. It says that the probability of some state is given as a sum of monomials, each of which is associated to a spanning tree of the graph. So I'm happy to talk more at the end about this result. But basically, this gives us a quite messy algebraic expression that works for any graph with any rates. And we don't put in rates to prove our results, but we reason about the structure of these expressions. They have a lot of structure. And the last ingredient is what were those different kinds of perturbations I was talking about? Well, you can always take a matrix of transition rates and parameterize it like this, introducing parameters associated to the vertices and two kinds of parameters associated to the edges, these symmetric ones and asymmetric ones. So this is like, there's like a sort of physics-y or chemical sort of interpretation of this, where the E's are like the energies of states, the B's are like barriers, energy barriers, and the F's are like forces that drive the system out of equilibrium. But you can always write rates like this, no matter what the interpretation is. Okay. So then, the first result is that if we vary these vertex parameters, and we're interested in the change in the probability, steady state probability of being at some state I, we have the following simple result, which is turns out to be exactly what you would get at equilibrium if you varied the energies in the Boltzmann distribution. This is kind of surprising, right? So we're out of equilibrium, but varying these parameters is just like varying the energies in the Boltzmann distribution. That's interesting. Exactly. So if I increase E in a state, it's like scaling all of the rates to leave by the same, like 1 plus epsilon, right? That's what we're doing. And if you do this, then it also implies, so that if some parameter of interest, lambda, only affects vertex parameters, then we have the following expression for the response of any observable, which is just like an equilibrium type response. We have that the sensitivity is equal to a covariance. The second result is that driving forces bound the sensitivity to these edge perturbations. So what this says is that if I raise a barrier, okay, which is like scaling symmetrically the forward and reverse rates on an edge, then the response, let's say, of a ratio of any observables to that is bounded by hyperbolic tangent of the cycle forces. In particular, the max of the cycle forces that involve that edge, the cycles that involve that edge. This is like adding an enzyme. It's a bit like adding an enzyme, changing a barrier height. So this, a special case of that result, for example, specializing to the probability of being in some collection of states, x, we have the following expression. Okay. The last result is is that a quantity called the support, which I'll define, bounds the sensitivity to all perturbations. So let's say we have some general kinetic scheme, and this parameter x appears in some transition rates. Okay. The support is the number of states that lie at the tails of the edges that depend on x. So if a state has an edge coming out of it, a rate coming out of it that depends on this parameter of interest x, I color it green. I count the number of greens. That's the size of the support, which I'm calling n here. And once I've done that, I have the following result, which is that, let's say, the response of a ratio of observables to changing this parameter x is less than m. Yes? Yes? Okay, yeah, so that's maybe a sort of a glitch in this figure. So here I'm only showing the transitions that depend on x. We could. There's also a backward transition that I'm not drawing. This became a bit schematic. Incidentally, you know, you can actually send rates to zero in this system, as long as the graph is still strongly connected, so you can get from anywhere to anywhere, things will still be okay. The only thing that happens is that the cycle forces will go to infinity. So that makes that result empty. But the other results will hold even if you have some irreversible edges. OK, so a special case of this result is the following. So if we specialize to the probability of being in some state, collection of states, x, then the response is given by the following expression. So this is kind of neat because I don't know if you remember, but this is like that hill-like expression. So n here is kind of playing the role of a hill coefficient. And in fact, there are many different definitions of the effective hill coefficient out of equilibrium, and the support bounds them all. Yes, exactly, exactly. Right. So, well, first of all, just to clarify, m is not the transition dimension on x, but it's the like where they come from, right? It's the set of states that they come from. The number of nodes. Yeah. So I know what you mean about these sort of partially observed Markov processes. I guess I don't know what exactly the application of a bound on sensitivity would be. In that case, but I'm there could well be one. I haven't thought about that. We can talk about that after maybe. Okay. Yeah. Interesting. So you know, first of all, you know, it could be obvious. There could be an argument by which it's obvious. Let's focus on the one where pi is small. So if pi is small, you're saying So I guess here's one sense in which I'm not sure it's obvious. If detailed balance held here, then you could easily be that m was, let's say, 10 or something, or some big number, but that a much smaller bound on this sensitivity held. What maybe is not trivial is that you have to, out of equilibrium, be able to choose kinetics or sort of arrange it so that all of these edges that depend on x sort of contribute to increasing the probability in this state pi x. To me, it's not clear that that's always possible. In fact, I'm not sure this bound can always be saturated. But yes, I'd be interested to know if especially in limits. There could be alternative ways to prove the result. It's worth saying that of all the results, this one is actually the one that's sort of easiest to prove. So I think it's very useful. It unifies a lot of things that people have noticed, and people have not noticed, as far as I know, this statement, but it is a bit easier to see than the others. So. Okay, for example, using this result, we can unify all of these examples, and we can say, for instance, that the effective Hill coefficient for all of them, for many observables that we could be interested in, is going to be bounded by the number of these green states. So we can, for example, revisit now the flagellar motor, where we can count the number of these green states, and the support bound in this case, so the number of them is 2n, this means that the support bound implies a limit where sort of 2n is sort of like the maximum Hill coefficient that can be achieved. So this bound can be saturated. It's possible to saturate. And so this is at least suggestive, you know, in the light of results, you know, like this one, where, you know, there is actually a factor of two difference here. And I think, you know, there's some complicating factors that maybe ruin that story slightly, but it's at least suggestive. Another application of these results is to kinetic proofreading. So I'm not going to have time to go into this in depth, I don't think. But kinetic proofreading is a mechanism, is a kinetic scheme shown here on the right, by which an enzyme can distinguish between two very similar substrates. And in recent papers, Murugan has argued that the ability of this scheme to discriminate can be quantified by a sensitivity, which is shown here. And I'm happy to talk more at the end about this, but combining our vertex and end perturbation results yields a refinement to Hopfield's results. So Hopfield, one of his results is that in this system, interpreted in the language of the discriminatory index, the largest value of this parameter nu is 2. These response results refine this and show that it's bounded by basically 1 plus tanh of delta mu over 4kT. And delta mu here is often, let's say, it might be the chemical potential of ATP hydrolysis, if that's what's driving this system out of equilibrium, which is around 20kT. So it's actually far in the flat regime there. So that's interesting. Okay, so the last example that I want to describe is also my favorite, maybe, which is an application of these results to unordered binding. So this is a very general situation where we have a ligand that can bind to, let's say, a macromolecule at any of n binding sites. Okay, so the number of states, the states in the system are any site can be bound or not. So there's like 2 to the n states. And the transitions are a site can be bound, and then the ligand can bind, and the ligand can fall off at any site. And let's suppose that the binding at one site can affect the rates at all the other sites in a sort of arbitrary non-equilibrium way. So in this case, the support bound yields, you know, a sort of extravagant-seeming exponential bound on the sensitivity, right? Where, because if we count the number of states that have a transition that depends on the ligand concentration coming out of them, we find it's all of them except for the fully bound one. So it's 2 to the n minus 1. And you know, when I first saw this, I thought, you know, for sure this couldn't be saturated. We tried to prove that a lower bound held. And in fact, numerical work that investigated this model in the context of gene regulation, they were thinking of the ligand as being a transcription factor binding to sites on DNA. And in eukaryotes, this can be thought to be a non-equilibrium thing sometimes. Investigating this model, they didn't find this exponential sensitivity. So I thought maybe the bound can't be saturated. But in fact, it can be. So for any n, we can approach the Hill function with h equals 2 to the n minus 1 as closely as we want by a simple mechanism that we've uncovered. And I didn't say, but for example, and in this example, the observable here could be the probability of being fully bound, the fully bound state. But it could be something else, and I think a similar, the construction can be adapted. Yeah, okay, yeah. So that's right. So I have an extra let me go to the slides. So here's how we construct the maximizer. So so let's start with one binding site. So in the one binding site, just imagine it comes on with the rate x, it comes off with the rate 1, let's say. Then the key thing is the following, that we can take this sensitivity for one binding site. And we can amplify it in the following way. So we can say that when the first site is bound, only then the next site can bind. And then once that site is bound, the second one, it can only fall off when the first one is empty. And this extends to all n. So the nth one can bind only if all of the n minus 1 are bound. And it can only fall off if all of the n minus 1 are unbound. And then that's not enough. The last thing we need is that a strong timescale separation, so that every site gets slower. So the first one is very fast, the second one is slower, and so forth. That's the mechanism. So it's not a complicated mechanism. But I believe that it was overlooked. And even though people have been interested in these kinds of models. So I think it's interesting, you know, once you have a limit, you know, it leads you to look for if it can be achieved, right? So that's can be useful. Okay. So that's it. So I just want to leave you with three further directions that I'm interested in. So the first, which is sort of the vaguest and sort of grandest one, is whether there is a sort of general theory of the relationship between structure and function in non-equilibrium systems. So, you know, sensitivity is just one aspect of function, but there are other things that we could be interested in. And I think that many of our tools to think about the relation between structure and function are sort of equilibrium type ideas. So maybe there's mileage to be had by looking for non-equilibrium things. The second is sort of what I was just saying, it's that basically, you know, there are situations like gene regulation in eukaryotes where there's a lot of molecular complexity, and we think there are non-equilibrium things going on, and it's plausible that sensitivity could be functionally important in these systems. So that means that knowing optimal mechanisms that, let's say, give you very high sensitivity could be a useful lens for interpreting what's going on in these systems. And finally, I think it's possible that there are sort of universal sort of links between sensitivity and first passage times that could be worth sort of investigating. Some authors have found results, for example, in that gene regulation context, where there are trade-offs between, let's say, speed and precision. And I wonder if they can be framed perhaps in the language of first passage times and generalized beyond beyond the context in which they were first uncovered. Okay, good. So thank you all for coming, and I've got a lot of other people to thank. First of all, Jordan Horowitz and Todd Gingrich, who are my collaborators on this work. Also, Jeremy Gunawardena, who has influenced my thinking, especially on this the application of these things to eukaryotic gene regulation, and then to my advisors, Leonid and Jeremy. And finally, part of this work has been published, so check out our paper, and the last part, hopefully, will be out soon. Thank you all very much. I'll leave that up. Yeah? So it depends what you mean by energetics. So maybe not. So there's two things to say. So results like this one, the kinetic proofreading result, and the driving force result, here we have a cycle force appearing, right? So that's related to energetics, right? But it's true that we're not expressing this in terms of currents, right? So the actual rate of energy dissipation, let's say, could be a cycle force like this times a current. And in fact, you're absolutely right. So our results don't have anything to do with that. And the reason is that you can scale every rate by a constant, let's say, to slow things down or speed things up, and it doesn't change these sensitivity results. They're all about the long time behavior, so it doesn't depend on, there's like an overall times factor that we can scale, and so there isn't going to be a trade-off between sensitivity in this context and energy dissipation rate, right, which has, because one is dimensionless, the other one has a time in it. Now, that's not to say that there couldn't be many interesting links, but we need to introduce some other time scale to make that comparison. Yeah. 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 Well, perhaps not. I mean, I guess the only thing I can say is that. It's something that I want to look into. I'm aware that there are results that relate sensitivities in Markov chains in general to I believe sort of differences of two hitting times. Let's say so there are results like those, and in the context of application to a particular system, often results about time, for example, in the gene regulation example, there'll be a question of time scale, and they compare the time for, let's say, the steady state to be established to maybe a particular rate that they hold constant, like the rate of binding. But that, you know, has a sort of slightly non-universal character, because there's this external constraint that you're putting in, which is how fast a particular rate is. If instead we were comparing, let's say, two first passage times, you know, each within the system, that's a kind of endogenous thing that I think could be more universalizable. Yeah. Cool. All right. Well, there's no more questions. Thank you. Let me just turn off Zoom. So the result, the 2020 result, the paper, you mean? Yeah, thanks. So the 2020 result is basically the results in 1 and 2. You know those three results that I had? The vertex perturbations, the edge perturbations. So 1 and 2 are the 2020 result. And the last one is the one that's about to